A very good morning, dear children. I hope you all are fine and safe with your family. Students, today in English, we will be learning a new lesson, that is lesson number 4.3, and name of the lesson is Red-Headed League Part 1, which is from unit number 4. The lesson Red-Headed League is one of the 56 Sherlock Holmes short stories written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. This story is filled with mystery and suspense, which keeps the reader wanting to know more. Let me introduce to you the characters of the story. Sherlock Holmes, Dr. Watson, he is also the narrator of the story, students. Jabez Wilson, Inspector Jones, Mr. Merriweather, Vincent Spaulding, and Duncan Rose. So, what is this story, students? Let's begin. Part 1. Mr. Wilson's story. When I called upon my friend, I means what, students? Narrator. Okay, students, so I is a narrator over here. When I called upon my friend, Mr. Sherlock Holmes, he was conversing with a visitor who was an elderly man with fiery red hair. Okay, so when narrator called his friend, Mr. Sherlock Holmes, that time what he was doing? He was talking to a visitor who was an elderly man with a fiery red hair. Holmes introduced me to the visitor, Mr. Jabez Wilson. Okay, so who was the visitor? Visitor was Mr. Jabez Wilson. He was a pawnbroker. Who was he? He was a pawnbroker. So what is the meaning of pawnbroker, students? Pawnbroker means a person who lends money at interest when things are kept with him till the loan is repaid. Holmes asked him to repeat his story for me. He began by showing us an advertisement in a newspaper. It read as follows. So what is written in the newspaper? We will be coming to know now. To the Red-Headed League. League means what, students? League means an association. Okay? And what it is there in that ad? There is a vacancy for a member of the league and the salary is £4 a week for nominal services. Red-headed men may apply in person on Monday at 11 o'clock to Duncan Rose at the office of the league, 7 Fleet Street. Okay, students? So, what is the meaning of this advertisement? It means that there is a vacancy for a member of the league and the salary will be £4 and they will be getting every week. Okay, so every week they will be getting £4 and that too for the nominal services. Who can apply? Red-headed men can apply in person. In person means what, students? Personally, they have to visit that place. Okay, and what is the timing? Timing is they have to visit that place around 11 o'clock. And after reaching that place, they have to meet Mr. Duncan Rose at the office of the league, 7 Fleet Street. So, this is what been written in that advertisement. The advertisement had appeared 2 months ago. Okay, so this advertisement had come in the newspaper around 2 months ago. Mr. Wilson's assistant, Vincent Spaulding, had shown it to him. Okay, so Mr. Wilson also had an assistant and the name of this assistant was Vincent Spaulding. That advertisement was shown by Vincent Spaulding to Mr. Wilson. Mr. Wilson liked his assistant Spaulding. Who liked his assistant Spaulding? Mr. Wilson. Why he liked him? Because he was smart, efficient and worked for only half the normal wages. Okay, so why he liked him? Because he was smart in his work, he was efficient and he worked only for half the normal wages. But the assistant also had his faults. Okay. But this assistant, that is Vincent Spaulding, had also some of his faults. Every now and then, he left work and went down into the cellar to develop photographs. Photography was his hobby. So, what is the meaning of cellar, students? Cellar means, it means a room below ground level in a house used for storing things. So, what was the hobby of his assistant, that is Vincent Spaulding? That he used to, photography was his hobby, and every now and then he used to leave his work and used to went down into the cellar to develop photographs. So, I hope students, this much must be clear with everyone. Spaulding showed the advertisement to Mr. Wilson and explained to him that an American millionaire, Mr. Ezekiel Hopkins, had founded the famous Red-Headed League to help all redheads like himself. Okay, so what Spaulding did, what his assistant did, what he did, he showed this advertisement to Mr. Wilson and it to explain to him that an American millionaire had founded this league so that all his red hats can be helped like himself. Spaulding urged Mr. Wilson to apply for the job. Okay, so Spaulding is telling Mr. Wilson that he's forcing him that he also can apply for this job. So, the two of them went to the address given in the advertisement. Okay. So, who all are going to this address? Spaulding is going along with Mr. Wilson. Fleet Street was full of red-headed people. Mr. Wilson thought that with so much competition, he would not get the job. So, because that Fleet Street was full of red-headed people, Mr. Wilson was thinking that there is so much competition, so he will not be getting this particular job. He wanted to go back, but Spaulding pushed through the crowd and took Mr. Wilson to the office. Okay, here the situation came that because it was so much competition, so that time Mr. Wilson wanted to go back. But what happened? Mr. Spaulding pushed through the crowd and took Mr. Wilson to the office. Now see what happens. There was nothing in the office but a couple of chairs and tables. A red-headed man sat behind the table. Okay, so as in when these two people had reached this office, there was nothing, only there was chairs and table, and there was a person who was red-headed man who sat behind the table. He was Mr. Duncan Rose, a representative of the Red-Headed League. So, who was there in that office? There was nothing. There was a person whose name was Mr. Duncan Rose and he was a representative of Red-Headed League. He was very pleased to see Mr. Wilson and announced immediately that he was well suited for the job. Okay, so after meeting Mr. Wilson, he was very pleased. And immediately he announced that he's very much well suited for this job. He shook hands with Mr. Wilson, congratulated him, and told all other candidates to go back. Mr. Duncan Rose explained that Mr. Wilson would have to be in office from 10 to 2. So Mr. Duncan Rose, what he did, he started explaining in detail about the job, what he has to do. So first thing that he has to be in the office, that Mr. Wilson is to be present in the office from 10 to 2. If he left the office, he would lose the job. That means from 10 to 2, he has to be in office. And if for any reason, if he's leaving the office, he had to lose his job. Spaulding assured Mr. Wilson that he would look after Mr. Wilson's business in his absence. So from 10 to 2, his assistant, that is Spaulding, he assured Mr. Wilson that till the time from 10 to 2, he will be taking care of his business when he will be in this office. The pay was fixed at £4 a week. So what was the salary which was being fixed for Mr. Wilson? That was £4 a week. Now see what happens. And the work, said Mr. Wilson. You have to copy out the Encyclopedia Britannica. So what was his job after reaching in that office? What he was supposed to do? He just had to copy out Encyclopedia Britannica. The pay was very good and the work was light. Mr. Wilson accepted the job and began his work the very next day. Okay, because the work was very light and the pay was very good, immediately Mr. Wilson also accepted the job, and from next day onwards, he started to begin with his new job. Mr. Duncan Rose was there in the office to see that Mr. Wilson did his work properly and did not leave the office. Okay, so who was Mr. Duncan Rose? He was a representative of Red-Headed League, and because Mr. Wilson also had joined his work, so he was there in the office to see that whether Mr. Wilson was doing his work properly. And one more thing, he was observing that whether he was leaving the office or not. He told Mr. Wilson to start with the letter A. Mr. Wilson wrote diligently for 4 hours without leaving his place. Diligently means what, students? Diligently means to do the work very sincerely and carefully. Okay. Mr. Rose would drop in from time to time to see that all was right with Mr. Wilson. At 2 o'clock, he bade Mr. Wilson. Bade means what, students? He told Mr. Wilson good day and locked the door of the office. Okay, so around 2 o'clock, Mr. Rose would drop from time to time, and around 2 o'clock, he used to tell Mr. Wilson good day, and then he used to lock the door of the office. I hope, student, this much must be clear with everyone. Now see, students, what happens. This went on day after day. Mr. Holmes, said Mr. Wilson, and on Saturday, I got my salary. So each and every day was passing like this, and on Saturday he got his salary. It was the same next week and the same the week after. Okay, so same thing was continuing. After a few days, Mr. Duncan Rose came in office only once in a while, and after a time he did not come in at all. Okay, so for some days Mr. Duncan Rose came in only once in a while, and after some time he didn't come only. Mr. Wilson continued, 8 weeks has passed like this, and I had written about Abbots, Arkery, etc., and hope that I might get on to be soon. Okay, and then suddenly the whole business came to an end. Okay, so if you remember, students, Mr. Wilson got the job of copying Encyclopedia Britannica, and he was told to start from letter A. Okay, so he has written about Abbots, he has written about Arkery, etc., and after some days he thought that he will be getting soon letter B. But what happened? Suddenly the whole business came to an end. To an end, Holmes asks. Yes, sir. This morning, I went to my work as usual at 10 o'clock, but the door was shut and locked with a little note nailed on it. It said, the Red-Headed League is dissolved. Dissolved means what, students? Here it means the organization has come to an end. Okay, students? So one day when he reached his office, as usual at 10 o'clock, that time the door was closed. Okay, it was closed and it was locked with a little note nailed on it. That means a little something was written in a piece of paper. And what it was written? It was written that the Red-Headed League is dissolved October 9, 1880. I was shocked. I did not know what to do. Immediately, Mr. Wilson, after reading this note, he became shocked because he was not at all aware what is going on. I was shocked. I did not know what to do. Mr. Wilson went on with his story. I made inquiries at the nearby offices, but none of them knew anything about the leak. Okay, so after when he got this note, he started making inquiries around the nearby offices. Nearby offices means what, students? The offices which was there nearby to his office. But none of them knew anything about the leak. The rooms had been rented under a false name. Okay, so what he came to know? That the room which was been rented, that was under a false name. Now see what happens. I went home and asked my assistant Spaulding for advice, but he could not help me in any way. So after reaching home, what Wilson did, Mr. Wilson did? He asked his assistant Spaulding for advice that what he should do now, but he could not help him in any of the way. I want to find out about the leak, Mr. Holmes, who they are and why they played this prank upon me. Okay, prank means what, student? It is an evil deed. Okay, so Mr. Wilson wants to find out why this was being played upon him. The whole thing is a mystery. That is why I came to you. I have heard a lot about you. Holmes found Mr. Wilson's story very unusual. He asked, Mr. Wilson, this assistant of yours who first called your attention to this advertisement, what is he like? So now Sherlock Holmes started making an inquiry. Now he started that he asked Mr. Wilson that this assistant which first called your attention to the advertisement, what is he like? Small, stout, with no hair on his face. He has a white splash of acid on his forehead. I thought as much, said Mr. Holmes. Is he still with you? Oh, yes, sir. That will do. Mr. Wilson, I can give you my opinion on this subject in a day or two. Today is Saturday, and by Monday we may come to a conclusion. So after hearing the whole story, Mr. Sherlock Holmes told that just give him some days and he will be giving his opinion on this subject within a day or two. So today is Saturday and by Monday we may come to a conclusion. So this was told by Mr. Sherlock Holmes. So I hope, students, this much story must be clear with everyone. What happens next? Today we have done, students, part 1. Part 2 will be continued in our next video. Till the time, students, go through the story once again and do understand the story. Stay safe and thank you so much. A very good morning, dear students. I hope you all are fine and safe with your family. Students, today in English, we will be continuing with our same lesson, that is lesson number 4.3, and name of the lesson is Red-Headed Leek Part 2. The Red-Headed Leek is one of the 56 Sherlock Holmes short stories written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. This story is filled with mystery and suspense, which keeps the reader wanting to know more. Students, before moving to our today's video, let me tell you all in short what all things we have learned in our last video. We have seen that this story is about a pawnbroker named Mr. Wilson who comes to Sherlock Holmes and Watson and tell them about a strange business with a group of red-haired men. He tells them that how his assistant encouraged him to apply for the job which he got. He started working for 7 weeks. In the 8th week, the office closes without any notice. Holmes finds something very fishy about the happenings as narrated by Mr. Wilson. So next what happens? Come, let's see. Main characters of the story are Sherlock Holmes, Dr. Watson, Jarvis Wilson, Inspector Jones, Mr. Merriweather, Vincent Spaulding, and Duncan Rose. Part 2. What happens next? Dr. Watson's account. Well, Watson, what do you think of it all? Asked Mr. Holmes after Mr. Wilson had left. Okay, now he's asking that, what do you think about all this? What all the things have been going on? I make nothing of it, I answered frankly. Holmes sat silently for some time and then invited me to go out with him. So what it means, after some, as in when Mr. Wilson left that place, Holmes and Watson just went out to find out something. We went to the square where Mr. Wilson had his shop. So after that, where they had gone? They had gone to the place where Mr. Wilson had his shop. Holmes observed the area carefully. Okay, so who started to observe the area carefully? Mr. Sherlock Holmes. There were many shops and offices in the square and a bank just behind Mr. Wilson's shop. Okay, students, so there were many shops in that area. There were shops, there were offices, but there was a bank just behind Mr. Wilson's shop. Holmes spent some time outside the shop and thumped upon the pavement 2 or 3 times. Okay, students, so what he did? After spending some time outside the shop, he thumped upon. Thumped upon means what, student? Hit something very hard. Okay, and what he hit? He hit the pavement. Pavement means what, students? Pavement means a kind of a roadway. Now, 2 or 3 times. Finally, he knocked on Mr. Wilson's door. Okay, so where he gone? He gone to Mr. Wilson's shop and there he knocked Mr. Wilson's door. A young man opened the door. Mr. Holmes asked him the way to the Strand. So after knocking the door, a young man opened that door. And as and when that young man opened the door, immediately Mr. Holmes asks the way to the Strand. Strand, student, it is a famous place in London. Okay, so he just asks the place of Strand, way to the Strand. The assistant answered the question and quickly closed the door. Okay, it's not like that the assistant didn't answer anything. He answered. But as in when he finished his answer, he immediately closed the door. So next what happens? Now we will see. I said, I am sure that you inquired your way only in order to see him. Not him, Holmes said, but the knees of his trousers. And what did you see? What I expected to see. This matter of Wilson's is serious. A crime has been planned. But I hope that we can stop it. The offices and banks will be closed for the weekend. Now I have to go and make some arrangements. But I shall want your help tonight. Come to Baker Street at 10 and bring your revolver. Okay, students, so what it means? As and when that young man closed the door, immediately Watson asked him, you had just knocked the door only to see him. Then Holmes replied, "I don't want to see him, but just I want to see the knees of his trousers." And then Watson asked that, "What did he see that time?" Holmes said that, "What I expected to see, I had seen that. The plan what he is planning, it is very serious. It's a crime which is being planned and we have to stop it. The offices and banks will be closed for the weekend. Now I have to go and make some arrangement, but I shall want your help tonight." Okay, so whose help Sherlock Holmes is asking? He's asking help of Watson. "Come to Baker Street at 10 and bring your revolver." So he's telling Mr. Watson that come to Baker Street at 10, and while coming, he also has to bring his revolver. Okay, students. So before moving ahead, I'd like to ask you all some questions. First question is, tell the name of the young man who opened the door to Mr. Holmes. So answer is, the young man who opened the door to Mr. Holmes was none other than Mr. Vincent Spaulding. So if you remember, student, Mr. Vincent Spaulding, he's none other than, he's the assistant to Mr. Wilson. Second question, what did Holmes want to see and why? Holmes wanted to see the knees of Mr. Spaulding's trousers. He wanted to see if the knees of the Spaulding's trousers were dirty or not. I hope, students, this much must be clear with everyone. Now moving ahead. I arrived at Holmes' residence in time. There were two other men with him. So I arrived means what? Mr. Watson arrived at Holmes' residence in time, and as and when he arrived that place, he saw that two other men was there with Mr. Holmes. One was Mr. Jones of Scotland Yard and another one was Mr. Merriweather. He was a banker. Holmes announced, "Tonight we are going to hunt one of the smartest criminals in London." We left together in a carriage and reached the road we had visited in the morning. Okay, so as and when Mr. Watson reached at Holmes' residence in time, that place, along with Mr. Holmes, there were two other people with him. One was Mr. Jones of Scotland Yard and another one was Mr. Merriweather. He was a banker. Immediately, all of them left together in a carriage and reached the road which they had already visited in the morning. Holmes told us to follow Mr. Merriweather, who led us through an iron gate. We followed him down a narrow passage. After going down some stone steps, he led us down a dark, earth-smelling passage and into a huge cellar. Cellar means what, students? It is a room used for storage under a building. Into a huge cellar full of big boxes. We all sat on the boxes. So what it means? After following him down a narrow passage, after going down some stone steps, he led us in the dark, earth-smelling passage and into a huge cellar. Okay, that cellar, they were full of big, big boxes. So after reaching that place, they all sat on those boxes. So what happens now? Come, let's see. We are in the cellar of the city branch of one of the main banks in London. Mr. Merriweather is the chairman of the bank and he will tell you why a criminal should take an interest in this cellar at present, said Holmes. So what Holmes is saying? He's saying that they all are in the cellar of the city branch of one of the main banks in London. And Mr. Merriweather, he is the chairman of that bank and he is going to tell everyone that why a criminal is going to take an interest in this cellar at present. Mr. Merryweather explained that the bank had borrowed a huge quantity of gold from the Bank of France and the boxes in the cellar were full of gold. Okay, students? So, why the criminal is going to take an interest in the cellar that time? This is the reason, because bank had borrowed a huge quantity of gold from Bank of France. Okay? So, bank has borrowed some huge quantity of gold from where they had borrowed from Bank of France, and the boxes which were being kept in that cellar were full of gold. So, I hope students, something must be clear in your mind that why the crime is going to take place in this cellar and why all these things are going to happen and it is happening. Okay, students, now. Holmes expected the criminals to act that very night. We had to wait there in total darkness without making any noise to take the criminals by surprise. They have but one escape route, whispered Holmes. That is, back through Mr. Wilson's house. I hope that some men are waiting at Mr. Wilson's door, Mr. Jones. I have an inspector and two officers waiting at his door. Then we have stopped all the holes. Now we must be silent and wait. So, what it means? Holmes expected that the criminals to act that very night. What Holmes expected? That whoever criminals will be, that night only they are going to come and they are going to, what all crime they had planned, they are going to do that. We have to wait there in total darkness without making any noise to take the criminals by surprise. To take the criminals by surprise means what, students? It means to catch the criminals without giving them a warning. So if they are making noise, criminals will come to know that someone is there inside. So they might just change their plan. Okay, so they were all being told that they were not supposed to make any noise. They have but one escape route. Escape route means what? Through which they can go outside, they can escape that place, whispered Holmes. That is, back through Mr. Wilson's house. Okay, so they have one escape route. And which is that escape route? It is the back through Mr. Wilson's house. I hope that some men are waiting at Mr. Wilson's door, Mr. Jones. Okay, so all were aware that there is a back one escape route. So there also some men were waiting at Mr. Wilson's door. I have an inspector and two officers waiting at his door. Okay, so who all were there at the Wilson's door? One inspector and two officers. Then we have stopped all the holes. Now we must be silent and wait. Now see, students, what happens. We waited silently for more than an hour. Okay, so silently they were waiting in that place for more than an hour. It was pitch dark in the cellar. Then suddenly, a point of bright light appeared in the floor of the cellar. Then a line and a gash seemed to open and the hand appeared. A broad stone turned over upon its sides and left a square hole. A boyish face emerged. So who had come from that square hole? A boy's face emerged. The man looked about and came out of the hole. So one man just came from that hole. He had a companion with him, a man with very red hair. So that person was not alone. He was also having a company. So who was that company? He was a man with a very red hair. The pair was not none other than Spaulding, the assistant, alas, the criminal Clay. Okay, students? So who was that person? He was none other than Spaulding. Who's Spaulding? If you remember, student, he was the assistant. Okay, he was the assistant of Mr. Wilson. Alas, he was none other than criminal Clay. Along with him, another person was the red-headed Mr. Duncan Rose. As soon as they climbed out of the hole, Sherlock Holmes sprang out and seized Clay by the collar. So as and when they came out, climbed out of the hole, Mr. Sherlock Holmes sprang out. Sprang out means what? Move or jump suddenly. And he seized Clay by the collar. I hope, students, this story, this much, what all things had happened, it must be clear to you all. I hope you all must be enjoying while seeing the story. I request you all to watch the story once again. The remaining part, what happens next, we will be continuing in our next video. Till the time, students, stay safe and thank you so much. A very good morning, dear students. I hope you all are fine and safe with your family. Students, today in English, we will be continuing with our same lesson, that is lesson number 4.3, and name of the lesson is The Red-Headed League, Part 2. This lesson, The Red-Headed League, is one of the 56 Sherlock Holmes short stories written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. This story is filled with mystery and suspense, which keeps the reader wanting to know more. It is about a pawnbroker named Mr. Wilson who comes to Sherlock Holmes and Watson and tells them about a strange business with a group of red-headed men. He tells them how his assistant encouraged him to apply for the job, which he got. He started working for 7 weeks. In the 8th week, the office closes without any notice. Holmes finds something very fishy about the happenings as narrated by Mr. Wilson. As soon as Spaulding and Duncan Rose climbed out of the hole, Sherlock Holmes sprang out and seized Clay by the collar. What happens next, we will be seeing in our today's video. Main characters of the story are Sherlock Holmes, Dr. Watson, Jarvis Wilson, Inspector Jones, Mr. Merryweather, Vincent Spaulding, and Duncan Rose. The other dived the hole and disappeared. Dived means what, students? It means jump. Okay, so if you remember, students, there were two of them who entered the cellar. Okay, one was Vincent Spaulding, alas Clay, and another one was Duncan Rose. Okay, students, so these two have entered the cellar. Now what happened? Other jumped down the hole and he got disappeared. Immediately, Clay took out a revolver. Okay, so what he had taken out? He had taken out a revolver. But Holmes hit him on his wrist and the revolver fell on the floor. "It's no use, John Clay," said Holmes. "We have caught you." Okay, so it is of no use taking out the revolver, Holmes is saying to John Clay. John Clay is none other than he's Vincent Spaulding only, assistant of Mr. Wilson.
we have already caught you.
So I see, but my friend has escaped. Now after hearing this that he is being caught, what he is saying? But my friend has already escaped. So who is his friend? His friend is none other than Duncan Rose. Now see what happens.
Holmes replied, he cannot escape. There are three men waiting for him at the other end.
Okay, so Holmes is further replying that how he is going to escape. There are three other people who's waiting for him at the other end. Okay, because they were knowing of the whole place. There was also one escape place from which, escape way from which they can go out. So already he has made three people standing over there. These people were not at all aware. Then Holmes handed over Mr. Clay to the policeman.
Mr. Merriweather said, really, Mr. Holmes, I do not know how to thank you. You have foiled one of the most cunning attempts at the bank robbery. Foiled means what? Prevented. Which was supposed to happen, but it couldn't happen. Okay? So, it was been prevented. So, that is the meaning of the term foiled. The bank is grateful to you. Okay, so the bank is grateful to you. Who said he is? It has been said by Mr. Merriweather to Mr. Holmes. Now, you see, Watson, Holmes said after we reached his home. Okay, now Holmes and Watson are talking to each other. It was obvious from the first that only possible object of the strange advertisement and the peculiar job was to get Mr. Wilson away from his shop for some hours every day. Okay, so first thing, what something different what it was about that strange advertisement, and second thing was peculiar job. Okay, so what was the main reason of all this? Only that Mr. Wilson should be away from his shop at least for some hour. That was the main motto. Then only all these things could be planned. If Mr. Wilson is there in the shop, Vincent Spaulding, he couldn't do anything if he's present in the shop. The red-headed league was a clever idea. In Mr. Wilson's absence, Clay and his red-headed companion wanted to dig an underground tunnel from Mr. Wilson's house to the bank. It is only possible if Mr. Wilson is not there in that place. Then only Clay and his red-headed companion, these both can dig an underground tunnel from Mr. Wilson's house to the bank. Then they would be able to enter the bank and steal the gold without breaking open the doors of the bank. Okay, so if the underground tunnel is been dig, then only from that place they can go inside and they can steal the gold without opening the doors of the bank. Using the tunnel, they entered the cellar. They planned to steal the gold and go back to Mr. Wilson's house again through the tunnel and then get away. Okay, students, so I hope you must have got the clear idea of how the crime was being planned but was not at all successful. Moving ahead. But how could you guess what their motive was?
When I heard that assistant work for half the wages, I became suspicious. Suspicious means for students, doubtful. Okay, why is assistant working for half the wages? So he became little bit doubtful. Who became little, he got a doubt? Mr. Holmes.
Using Mr. Wilson's description of his assistant, I made inquiries.
Who started making inquiries? Mr. Sherlock Holmes.
I found that he was the criminal Clay.
Okay, so after making inquiries, what he find out? He find out that his real name is not Vincent Spaulding, but his name is Criminal Clay.
Why was he working in Mr. Wilson's shop?
And
his habit of going into the cellar every now and then. So now the question arises, if he is a criminal, then why he is working in Mr. Wilson's shop? And in spite of working in the shop, why he is having the habit of going into the cellar every now and then? I infer that. Infer means what, students? Conclude. Okay? I infer that he must be digging a tunnel to some other building. So, how he came to know that he is digging a tunnel? Because Clay was a criminal. Okay? So, something must be going in his mind. So, again and again going into the cellar, that means some crime he is being planned. I infer that he must be digging a tunnel to some other building. When we visited the shop, I beat upon the pavement with my stick to find out the cellar stretch out in front or behind. It was not in front. I saw the bank on the other side of the house and guessed what the criminals had in mind. When Clay answered the bell, the knees of his trousers were wrinkled and strained. Okay, wrinkled and strained means what? It was dirty. Stained means was, it's what, dirty. If you remember, students, when Clay answered the bell, okay, and when he opened the door, so that time Vincent Spaulding, alas, Clay, knees of his trousers were wrinkled and stained. It confirmed my suspicion that he was digging. So after looking at the knees of his trouser, he came to know that he is doing something wrong. That means he was digging. You know the rest of the story. You reason it out beautifully, I exclaimed in admiration. Adapted from The Red-Headed League by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. I hope, students, this much must be clear with y'all. Before finishing this lesson, let me ask y'all few questions. Explain the trick of the red-headed league. How was it related to Mr. Wilson's hair? The red-headed league was a clever idea of Mr. Spaulding and Mr. Rose to keep away Mr. Wilson from his home for some time during the day so they could dig a tunnel from Mr. Wilson's house to the bank in the hope of stealing the gold from the bank without breaking open the door of the bank. The red-headed league was no way connected to Mr. Wilson's hair. It was just a way to get Mr. Wilson out of the house for some time. Next question is, why did Holmes become suspicious? Mr. Holmes became suspicious when he heard that Mr. Spaulding, Mr. Wilson's assistant, worked only for half wages. How did Holmes find out that assistant was a criminal? Mr. Holmes used Mr. Wilson's description of his assistant, made further inquiries, and find out that Mr. Spaulding was none other than Clay, a criminal. So I hope, students, everything must be clear with y'all. Here we come to the end of the story. We have already completed part 1 and part 2 of Red-Headed League. I hope you all must have enjoyed. I request you all to once again watch the video and you all can clear your doubts. Till the time, students, stay safe, and thank you so much.